In the mornings, I drive my children to school, which I love.
Yes.
I like to play various music for them.
Sure.
Yesterday was Kickstart My Heart by Motley Crue.
Oh, boy.
Which, yeah, I think is a song about cocaine. I'm not really
pretty
sure.
Pretty much. Yeah, yeah. Sure.
And then today was Nine Inch Nails Closer to God,
okay.
Which, as you all know, in the chorus talks about doing things to an animal.
Quiet, please.
That you probably would not want to do at the Easter table.
In four.
So we're looking for new schools.
Three, two.
Company presents a truly terrible podcast. Welcome to Nonsense Season 2, Episode 20. I'm Jeff Parker.
I'm Steve Little.
This is our take on the week's business, tech, and entertainment headlines. This time, we'll look at pulling the rug out from under you.
That's going to be a very strong tractor to do that.
Huh?
I'm heavy.
It's World Turtle Day.
I love turtles.
Turtles. Tortoises are pissed today. They are not being celebrated. They are livid.
Is that why they were picketing out in front of
yes.
The UN? Okay, now I understand.
Pickets, the whole thing, understandable. Nevertheless, happy turtle day. Do you have any plans for Turtle Day? Are you doing anything exciting?
Wait, turtles and tortoises, these are the same or these are different? I always confuse these two.
I understand that they're different. Turtles sometimes live in the water. Tortoises only live on the land. Turtles live up to the age of 40, have streamlined, mostly flat shells. Tortoises can live up to 300 years, and they have larger, more domed shells. That's everything I know about turtles and tortoises. Can we talk about cicadas?
So the tortoise is more like Cybertruck shaped? Is that what you mean?
Sure it is.
A little more boxy?
And has rust stains on the outside.
Yeah, totally.
Too.
Yeah, and it will just chop your finger right off, just like a Cybertruck. Perfect. Okay.
How is your week going?
Oh, my week's been great. I really have no complaints. I have no affinity for golf.
Okay.
I'm very happy to be outside and drinking, but I just chasing a golf ball doesn't sound like a lot of fun to me.
Yeah.
But I took my children to a kid's birthday party at a miniature golf course.
Yes.
And my kids played the fastest round of miniature golf I have ever seen.
Speed miniature golf.
Yeah. They would not stand still and hit the ball. They would just smack the ball and then chase it. So it was like polo and hockey. Had a baby, and I was annoyed for the first three holes. Then I was like, I'm gonna be done in 8 minutes. Why do I care?
I'm out of here.
And it was great. And at one point, my kids literally, there's some other parents playing with children on the course, they just ran right through their hole doing the same thing. I'm like, I'm so sorry. And they just like blew right by. And the parents thought it was super funny. I was mortified. And we just went right, and I was like, all right, fine, we're done.
And then how were their scores compared to the other kids? Even though they were going fast, did they keep their scores competitive?
I think, I'm not sure. I'll have to ask my children. I think they were playing on time and not score. They were literally trying to see who could be done first. I think that was the goal. So you heard it here first. It's a whole new speed miniature
Your
golfing
kids
thing.
Believe in the W.C. Fields line that golf is a good walk spoiled.
Yes. Well, for them it was a good run spoiled, I think was really what they were shooting for. It was a lot of fun. You just can't not giggle about children playing miniature golf for the first time. How about you? How was your week?
I had a pipe that leaked.
Ooh.
And leaked into three levels of rooms. So I have a basement ceiling that's destroyed.
Sure.
I have a room above that with the ceiling destroyed.
Okay.
And the room above that is where the leak was. And the leak was very high in that room, so most of that drywall is destroyed. So I don't know why I ever thought it was a good idea to live in a house. Why did man decide to live indoors? This was a mistake.
You know what they say about water? It's at least it's consistent.
Flows down.
Yep. Consistently flows down.
Well, this is going to be a huge repair job. It's going to take a long time, and as it turns out, it's not going to be free.
No. They make you pay for those things, as it turns out.
Let's get to our headlines.
Let's do it.
China is looking to add its own 25% tariff on U.S.-made electric vehicles. This is after the U.S. increased its tariff on Chinese electric vehicles from 25 to 100%.
Oh, America's still ahead.
Yes, we are.
Nobody can tariff like us.
Researchers have found a link between stomach paralysis and Ozempic-type drugs.
Look, as if fat people aren't having a hard enough time as it is, now they're fucking paralyzed, right?
And this is the show we get canceled.
I'm telling you... Yeah, that's the one. We better get on that idea of the flying Golden Corral buffets. We can bring the buffet to the paralyzed fat people. We're prophetic.
Wonderful.
This is great.
It has been lovely doing this show with you.
Has it, though? Has it really?
Massachusetts insurance companies canceling homeowners policies using drone and other aerial photos.
Well, of course they are. I keep letting them land the fucking buffet on my roof. They're not going to insure me for that.
And the U.S. government is urging federal contractors to use stronger encryption.
Wait, what do you mean? Like specific, like emojis?
Yes, just do all your messaging in emojis, please.
I'd love to see that memo to all federal contractors. Please only speak in emojis, by the way. And then it says no eggplant and no peach next to it.
Well, then what's the point of emojis?
Are we doing these headlines like super fast now?
These are things we were never going to get to. So
sure.
I thought I'd just throw a little,
put them at the top.
Little snippets at the top so we could just at least mention them because they're worth mentioning. Now we can get to the ones we're going to spend more time on.
I'm glad we did that once on our last show. That's great. That's perfect. Man, we have so many good ideas on the show that we don't execute. Imagine if you could see emoji use by zip code. I think that would tell you a lot. Like if you knew the most used emoji in a given zip code.
Why would zip code matter? Why would that make any difference?
Because I would think by zip code it would be very telling. Like, I'm assuming for you, in your zip code, it would just be a lot of the money with wings just landing okay. in your...
Or
in
just your, walkers. Is there an emoji that's a walker?
It's not even emojis. It would be an emoji of a fax machine because it would be people literally faxing right. each other. I can tell you based on next door in my neighborhood, it would just be like coyotes because that's all the people talk about here.
All wild animals, yeah,
the
sure.
coyotes. Oh, did you see the coyote? I'm like, you remember we live in their neighborhood, right?
We are the guests, not them.
We are the guests, exactly.
Google's new Add to Chromebook badge makes web apps easy to install. Google is making a new Add to Chromebook badge for PWA so that you can install them on sure. Chromebooks very, very easily. The interesting thing to me about the Chromebook, though, you know, Macintosh has come out with the new, whatever those things are, the computers? M3 sure. M3 chipped MacBook.
Jesus, what hole do you live in exactly? Just because
Windows is also coming up now, yes. a similar sort of thing where they're using...
Let me help our users
Tell me
out.
What it is. It's the yeah. Elite Snapdragon. What's the
what,
thing called?
What Jeff is trying to say is that computer companies are coming out with new computers. I think that's what he's trying to say.
And the amazing thing to me is, uh-huh. at least as I see, my kid will be the last generation of kids who sure. went through schools using MacBooks because it seems like every school sure. I hear about, yeah. they are all using Chromebooks now because they're yeah. so much cheaper. So those kids are all going to come out of school sure. very comfortable on Chromebooks.
Yeah, I agree with that.
Most of what they're doing is browsing. Most of what they're doing yeah. is stuff they can do on web apps anyway.
Cat videos.
Yeah. Well, cat videos, sure.
Yeah, yeah, a lot of that. I get that.
In other Google news, yeah. Google has sent the DOJ an unexpected check in an attempt to avoid
this is great.
Monopoly jury trial. Just preemptively, they said, here's all the money that you have won.
I love this.
Now let's not have the trial.
This is such a great story because, first of all, this is one of those things where I read it and I had to double check the URL to make sure I wasn't on the Onion.
Oh, for sure.
It felt like an Onion story.
Every dollar the United States could conceivably hope to recover yes. is in this yes. check.
So the DOJ has a case against Google where I believe they're representing some federal agencies that they say have overspent. And Google has looked at what experts have said and they've sent a check to the U.S. government that said this is more money than these experts have said you could possibly gain in a trial. And by the way, we're sending you money that you're not going to have to spend on experts now.
Right. Like, you're going to save a fortune here.
The trial is going to cost more than the money you're going to make.
Here's your winnings.
Here's your winnings. Please just move on.
Just accept it.
So at first when I read this, I was like, holy shit, this is like a pretty bold move, right? Surely sure. this hasn't been done before.
It seems very innovative.
Right? You're just like, okay. And did they find case law where they've done this before? Turns out they didn't have to look very far because the U.S. government itself did the same thing last year in 2023 where the government was sued by a citizen demanding a tax refund.
Yeah.
And the U.S. argued that a full payment of the tax refund mooted the plaintiff's damage claims and insisted that the court agree the case be mooted even if the check was never cashed because a plaintiff, this is a quote, a plaintiff may not prolong a case merely by refusing to accept a valid tender.
Why was the plaintiff trying to prolong the case?
I don't know.
He just didn't want the money? He was trying to make a point? If he was suing for money, that's what he wanted, right?
I don't know. Maybe he didn't get the refund in the way that he wanted. I have no idea. I didn't dig into the case.
He wanted it in rolls and rolls of pennies.
The U.S. government did themselves no service when they said in this case last year that they, quote, assured the court the same mootness rule would apply if the party's positions were reversed. Well, guess what, assholes? They are reversed,
it's
now.
Reversed.
And I love that Google just played a giant fucking Uno reverso card on the U.S. government. They're just like, now what, fuckers? What do you want to do now? So this is really fascinating to me. Obviously, they want to avoid a trial.
I was not aware of the 2023 case.
Dude, I got to believe that there was like a junior associate at this law firm that read about this case and had it in their back pocket.
Oh, yeah.
And they were just waiting for the time to play it. And then they saw it here and they're like, wait a minute. Google makes like, what, a bajillion dollars a minute? How about we just go throw $1 million at the U.S. government with this argument and see what happens? Like, it's absolutely
we
brilliant.
Don't know what the check was. That actually was redacted.
Yeah, it was redacted.
We don't
redacted.
Know how much they sent. They originally say the estimates were initially between $100 million and $300 million. At one point, the estimated yeah. damages were less than $1 million.
Less than $1 million. If I had to guess, this is a high six-figure check. Like, it's a high six-figure, maybe low seven-figure check. So you're talking about like $1 million plus or minus a couple hundred grand. And look, these law firms are not cheap, especially when Google's your client.
For sure.
For Google, they're just like, well, this is going to be less of an operating expense than fighting it. So let's just make it go away. It's fantastic.
If, in fact, that's the amount that the DOJ says is the correct amount. It's easy on the tax refund because sure. you know exactly what the man is suing for. It's a finite amount of charges. In this case, I think that the number could move.
Here's what's interesting about this, though. They didn't say this in this article, but Google did not make the check. They didn't just like make it out to the DOJ. Like, who do you put on the two line? So they just put Bob Menendez.
Oh, there you go.
Right? And they're just like, well,
Bob will shut it down. Bob will shut
we
it
don't
down
know.
For you.
Do you want this in cash, Bob, or just in the regular gold straight into your freezer like we normally do?
Do you like this in carpet for your basement?
Yeah. It's a checkbox. DOJ, you get your choice. You can have this $1 million or we'll carpet all of your basements. Your choice.
Okay, now with the headlines. Up next, we're going to talk about rug pulls.
Pug rolls?
Pug rolls? I don't know. Is that like a dog?
Can scam? I think so.
Do our mics still work? Are you hearing anything I'm saying? All right, let's go.
Oh my God, that was funny. Oh. As I've mentioned before on this show of ours, the number of scams for mainly for you to avoid is pretty much endless.
Do I fall prey to a lot of scams?
I only fall prey to the one. There's the one scam I have to avoid. You have an endless number of scams to avoid.
I fell prey to the one that you said, hey, let's start a podcast.
Yes, I know. That's the gift that keeps on giving, though.
I just tripped right into that
one. So this will not surprise you. I don't think this will surprise really any of our listeners. But financial scams really exploded when cryptocurrency became mainstream.
Oh, that's not true.
More mainstream, right?
Financial crimes really exploded when finance was first invented.
That's what I'm saying. When finance started is really when the scam started.
For sure.
That's what I meant to say.
Financial scamsters did not waste a second.
Yeah, the SEC exists because of financial scams, right? I mean, that's how it came into existence. According to the FTC,
yes.
If you believe them.
I generally do.
Generally, I do as well. More than 46,000 people reported losing over $1 billion in crypto to various scams between January 2021 in June of 2022.
So roughly 18 months we're talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And that figure only includes people who were willing to share information with the authorities.
I was just going to say, how would the FTC have a way of tracking that?
Okay, so just that 46,000 people, that if you do the math, if you divide and you carry the one, that's like $22,000 per person. So it's not a small number.
Yeah.
I believe the actual loss per person on the median is more like $3,000-ish in that time period, which tells you there are some people that lost a lot of fucking money.
Ton of money
in crypto,
right?
Yeah. Now, most people that I have found, at least, maybe our show listeners are different, tend to know very little when it comes to how digital currency works or how to keep their digital assets safe, because it is different than putting money in a cereal box in your freezer. It's not a lot different, but it is a little different. And since cryptocurrency payments do not come with any legal protections or government assurances by design, crypto scams are especially attractive for thieves and scammers, right?
Yeah.
And also, I really find this funny that I have to note this, that I feel obligated to note this, but also note that there's no bank or other centralized authority to flag suspicious crypto transactions, and that all crypto transfers are irreversible.
That's right. It's like sending a wire.
Well, I'd argue
in that way.
I'd argue it's way worse than sending a wire, but
yeah.
It's like sending a wire to a fictitious bank on Mars.
Yes.
Is more, I think, what it's analogous to.
On wires, the federal government will track you if you send over $10,000. If you move it $10,000 of any sort.
But I still think there's no mechanism by which to return it. You need them to wire it back to you if you want it back. Okay, so I want to talk a little bit about crypto scams. Starting out somewhat simply with things to look for, right? And really, I found that your crypto scams, they're going to have the same basic high-level indicators that your good old-fashioned regular financial scams would have, right? Anything that seems too good to be true likely is. So if someone's offering you some crypto that seems insane, don't buy it.
Okay.
Nobody's going to offer you free crypto for doing practically nothing, unless, of course, you're an influencer like us. But you like really simply a little bit of Googling, you can figure out pretty quickly if
what the scam is.
Yeah, if there's any data behind, you know, to back up sort of their claims. This one's nuts to me. These pay-to-play job postings. People are apparently falling for this. There's a lot of them where they're saying, oh, we've got a job for you, or we want to secure you a position in this crypto industry, but you have to make an upfront payment in order to get in. Promises of guaranteed returns, also typically not a good thing. Nobody can promise guaranteed investment returns.
Oh, that's not true.
Despite what your hedge fund bro swears to you, there's no guarantee.
I can absolutely guarantee you returns in several ways.
Really?
If you hold your money in cash,
yes.
I will guarantee you an annual average loss of 2.5% per year over the course of, say, a century.
This is like the people that go to casinos and they go, oh, they have a 98.7% payback on slots. And I'm like, that's fucking terrible. They're like, no, it's really good. I'm like, compared to what?
Every time you put in a dollar, you get 98 cents back.
To be fair, compared to roulette, that is a pretty good deal. But you're comparing it to roulette, the worst game in Vegas. Actually, I think the wheel is the worst game in Vegas, but that's for another show. So other than your guaranteed negative return, we're going to go ahead and say that's an indicator. Also, unexpected communications. This is like my favorite.
Okay.
If you get an email or a phone call or text from someone that wants you to log into a crypto account and, you know, or send them crypto to resolve some issue or some business opportunity, that's probably not legitimate.
Yeah.
So you should do what I do for my legitimate texts and emails. Just ignore all of them.
That's why I never hear back from you.
I have gotten so much worse as I've gotten older. I just can't be bothered. I treat the, you know, the little message indicator on my iPhone that tells me the number of things in the thing. I treat that like a high score on like Pac-Man.
Nice.
And I just see how big I can get it. I just don't care. I really just don't care anymore. some examples of these. You have like your blackmail, extortion, romance scams. I kind of put those all into the same bucket.
Okay.
Somebody will claim they have embarrassing personal information for you. They'll include your own photos or video, try to lure you into this trap. They'll threaten you that, hey, I'm going to make this information public.
I sent that guy 3 or 4 Bitcoin and he never exposed me.
Oh, yeah.
That was legit. That
guy just happened to look like me. Don't worry. I bought that story up until you said you sent him 3 Bitcoin. And then I knew you were bullshitting when you said not only exactly, not only just the part of you having Bitcoin and then you sending him. Like, okay, boomer, sure. How'd you do that? Oh, I put him in an envelope. I printed him out and put him in an envelope. Uh-huh. Sure you did, Jeff. Okay. No problem.
I sent him a Bitcoin check. You can do that, right?
I went into the post office and got a Bitcoin money order at the crypto post office. You know, this is funny. I just had a friend a couple weeks ago. It's not funny. It's telling. Who received a call in the late evening from his mother. He picked up the phone and all he heard was her sobbing. And before she could say anything, he's thinking like, fuck, my dad died, right? Like this is terrible.
Yeah, right, right, sure.
And before she could say anything, some aggressive voice he's never heard before gets on the phone and says that he's got to send them money right now or he's going to kill his parents. You know, you got to do this right away and send it to this crypto address, yada, right, yada, yada. Right. And my buddy was like, this sounds like bullshit. So of course he called the police. He called his mother's phone back. She answered. She was asleep. And she's like, why the fuck are you waking me up?
Of course she was.
And what's nuts about this is that somebody had spoofed, obviously, her number, but then knew to call him to try to extort. So
somebody had a lot of information.
Yeah, that's a pretty scary one, right? And if you look at the amount of info that's out there, especially if you look at like all of these public domain databases that show you related, you know, people at this address or names are related or whatever, I could see somebody backing into this. And I thought that was pretty nuts. Fortunately, he didn't get scammed and his parents were safe and just fine. Other types of this scam have people pretending to be your love interest and, you know, they weave a bunch of web of lies about themselves.
She promised me she was.
We've all been there. Catfish is delicious. Now, sadly, some of my friends have fallen for these romantic scams.
Sure.
But they just refer to them as their first marriages. You have these business opportunity investment scams. This is probably one of my favorites. When some random contact tells you they have a business opportunity that they want, you know, your help with and that you're guaranteed to grow rich.
Sure.
All you gotta do is send them some crypto. Like,
that's all you gotta do.
Folks, you do not have a distant cousin in Kenya. Just let it go. It's not a thing. You don't have one. I mentioned this earlier, the fake job listing scams. These are still nuts to me, that they'll like unsolicited job offers to try to lure people in. You got to pay some application fee or something. In what world does this exist? This is not a real thing.
Also, why do I want a job?
Well, there's that.
I'm never going to want a job from some rando on the internet.
There's that. Yes.
Yeah. I don't know you. I don't know your company. I have plenty of opportunities that will fill my time otherwise.
The giveaway scam, again, sort of what I said earlier, like no one's giving you money for free. There was one not too long ago where some crypto scammer was trying to impersonate Musk on Twitter to get people to send in their digital assets and like promised, you know, whatever, some freedom giveaway and free crypto to the first whatever 1,000 people, like all just some stupid shit. What's nuts about this is that while they typically feel like sort of MLM, you know, multi-level marketing scams,
sure,
some of them actually might be, which always surprises me.
Oh, for sure.
Look at them and I'm like, oh,
totally.
That's how this like really shitty Ponzi scheme was set
it's
up.
It's like a chain mail.
And then of course we talked about this on previous episodes, the impersonation and phishing scams. Those are super popular. They'll say they're from, the government or law enforcement. Enforcement to try to gain some credibility and convince you that your accounts are frozen as part of an investigation. You've got to pay them in crypto to resolve the issue.
I'll get right on that.
This does not happen. This does not happen
right
in the U.S. The FBI doesn't show up with a fucking Zelle QR code and they're like, hey, we're going to investigate you for, you know, whatever, for importing small wooden figures from Thailand. Or you could just send me $100 via Zelle and then I go away. That's not how that works.
The whole thing goes away.
Fake wallets and exchanges. I'm shocked that these still work, but apparently there are stats on this and they do, where they'll just get folks to like put their crypto into some fake online wallet where they just siphon them all from,
sure,
which is kind of fascinating to me and leads into my favorite, of course, I save for last. And I put these all in the same bucket, the Ponzi scheme, the pump and dump, and the rug pull.
I love rug pull.
Oh yeah. That's what we're gonna talk about today, right? That was my impetus for this whole segment was rug pull.
Yeah.
You'll get like typically a group of people, they get together to entice others into investing in a particular coin. They pump it up. They use social media, get super exciting. And then at some point, all of the money just disappears.
Sure. Just vanishes. Right.
Right? All the cash leaves. They try to get it at whatever the top of their quote market is, and they pull these all out. Some of these are nuts.
Okay.
And that's what I thought you would really enjoy today.
Fantastic.
Obviously, like, if you think about these from a transaction count perspective, I suspect most of them are these smallish one-off scams, right? Someone's extorting you because they called your phone number or whatever. But that last class that I mentioned, those Ponzi, pump and dump, and rug pulls are just massive when you think about the amount of money that gets sucked up.
Is that right?
Well, I'm leaving FTX aside, right? FTX, to me, is a different animal.
Yeah, sure.
That wasn't a Ponzi scheme, at least not at the start. I mean, he did take a bunch of money and put it somewhere else, but he wasn't promising people returns. These two that I want to highlight today are pretty nuts because from the get-go, I think they were, let's just say, problematic. My favorite, the one I think most people have heard of, if you pay attention to this stuff, is called OneCoin.
Okay.
Do you remember OneCoin?
I don't, but that doesn't mean it wasn't huge.
I mean, it was just one coin. How could you not know about the one coin? The only one you needed to know. So OneCoin launched in like late 2014. It was not a decentralized cryptocurrency, but it was a centralized pyramid scheme that these OneCoin folks hosted, marketed as a cryptocurrency.
Okay.
It was set up by, I'm going to screw up her name. I think it's Ruja Ignatova and Sebastian Greenwood, who was sort of the lead distributor in this pyramid. According to OneCoin, its main business was selling educational material for cryptocurrency trading. Investors could buy, quote, educational packages costing anywhere from like 100 euros to 120,000 euros. Supposedly, some people saw packages as much as 230,000 euros.
For information they could have gotten free from some 12-year-old on YouTube.
So in one of the suits from one of the former investors, much of the content in these packets was plagiarized from various free sources, including Wikipedia.
Of course. Right?
I think somebody even highlighted that they saw the like reference needed citation in some of the copy, which just makes me giggle. A bunch of people lost money. I shouldn't laugh at that, but it just makes me giggle. And then investors would receive these, quote, tokens that could be assigned to mine one coins, whatever in the fuck that means.
No.
And mining was said to take place at two sites in Bulgaria and one in Hong Kong.
Why do you have to be at a specific location to mine the coins?
Also, why would you mine it in Hong Kong where you have some of the most expensive real estate in the world? Like, but you're doing it in Kowloon? Like, what are you doing? In these typical OneCoin recruiting meetings, recruiters would focus on cryptocurrency investment and the sort of, quote, educational material was barely mentioned.
Okay.
The only way to exchange one of these, you know, OneCoins for other currencies was in the OneCoin exchange. So they own the marketplace. Now, this is the interesting part to me of their sort of initial business. I hate even calling it a business, their initial scam.
Mm-hmm.
You could only trade, your coins for euros in this sort of, from this virtual wallet, but your daily selling limit was based on which package you had invested in.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So if you wrote a check for more money into the Ponzi scheme, then you could pull a slightly larger portion of the fraction of money a fraction of the money you put in out.
Wow.
Which is just like, how is that not a giant red flag? As the lead distributor of this, 5% of all OneCoin sales went to Greenwood. So he made over $300 million on this thing.
Wow.
Which is bonkers. By 2016, several countries, including Italy and Hungary, had issued warnings that OneCoin is a pyramid scheme. So, you know, a couple years in, countries are already like, this does not seem right.
It took a couple of years.
Even the experts in identifying pyramid schemes, right? The Direct Sellers Association in Norway warned against OneCoin.
Uh-huh.
Now, when direct sellers are calling you a pyramid scheme, you've got a real fucking problem.
Sure.
They know what a pyramid scheme looks like. So when they're going, yeah, you are definitely not doing this right, that is a good sign that they're probably bullshitting a whole bunch of people. That's 2016. In June of 2017, Ruja Ignatova, the CEO of OneCoin, claimed that OneCoin was licensed by the Vietnamese government and that it was legally permissible to use them as a digital currency. And it was the first cryptocurrency in Asia officially licensed by any government. That is a pretty bold statement.
Was any of that true?
4 days later, Vietnam's Ministry of Planning and Investment issued a statement that the document which OneCoin used as proof was forged.
There you go.
They stated the document was against the MPI regulations and that the person who supposedly signed the document was not in the position claimed by the document at the time when the document was created. So it was fake. And they warned any individuals and enterprises to be vigilant if they encountered the document during business. So that's another kind of big strike against you.
Mm-hmm.
That was June of 2017. Shortly thereafter, she disappears.
Okay.
And the belief is she was tipped off that there was a secret U.S. warrant that was filed for her arrest. Her brother, Konstantin Ignatov, took her position. By 2018, the Bulgarian police raid OneCoin's office at the request of prosecutors in Germany. CBS, not the station, the Central Bank of Samoa, banned all foreign exchange transactions related to OneCoin and OneLife. CBS described OneCoin as a, quote, very high-risk pyramid scheme.
Sure.
So now by 2018, it seems like most of the world has figured out that this thing is not legit.
Cat's out of the bag.
U.S. prosecutors have alleged that the scheme brought in approximately $4 billion worldwide.
Wow.
In China, law enforcement recovered about 1.7 billion yuan. That's about almost $300 million, while prosecuting 98 people. Most of the leaders have now either disappeared or been arrested, although Ignatova escaped arrest. In March of 2019, her brother was arrested. He pleaded guilty to charges of money laundering and fraud later that year. He served 34 months and was just released earlier this year in 2024.
Wow.
Her collaborator, the OneCoin co-founder, Sebastian Greenwood, he was arrested in Thailand in July of 2018. He was imprisoned in Thailand pending extradition to the U.S., ultimately pled guilty in 2023, and was sentenced to 20 years for wire fraud and money laundering.
Okay.
And still serving time.
Yeah.
So got him. As of this recording, Ignatova's whereabouts are unknown, and she sits on both Europol's and the FBI's most wanted list, which is kind of nuts.
How high up on the list is she?
She's in the FBI's top 10 most wanted list. Like,
oh, top 10. Okay.
Oh, yeah. No, they like... Her picture's up there, first row, fourth to the right.
She's at my post office.
She is at your post office. Which, by the way, something I discovered in researching for this article, I didn't know this. It is a federal crime to alter the FBI's top 10 most wanted list.
How would you alter it? How would I alter the FBI's 10 most wanted list? If I like drew a mustache on her at the post office?
Theoretically, your co-host of this show may be putting your picture on those at the post office for years.
Sure.
I had no idea it was a federal crime. I just thought it was funny. I'm just putting Jeff's picture up there, just hoping somebody recognizes you. Yeah, exactly. Number 11. He's not really wanted. Did they just, he's interesting. Most interesting. The FBI's most interesting poster. So yeah, anyway, that was fascinating to me. You don't see a lot of nonviolent criminals that make that list. I happen to have known at least one of them, but you don't see a lot of nonviolent criminals that make that list.
That's crazy.
Okay, so that's one coin. Real money. The rumor is she's in Frankfurt. I don't know how she'd be fucking hiding in Frankfurt. Like, Frankfurt is the most boring town on the planet.
Sure, sure, sure.
How she's hiding there is beyond me. It's a really good ramen place there, but other than that, sorry, Frankfurt, it's a travel show now. This next one, to me, is kind of more nuts. I'll try to do this quickly. These guys launched same-ish time, right? They launched in 2017 by, and I'm going to completely butcher this guy's name, Faruk Fatih Ozar, and he started Thodex. Thodex was the first global exchange based in Turkey. At the time that it froze, it had over 391,000 users and an estimated $2 billion in money from investors when he ended up fleeing Turkey.
Okay.
Do you know any of this story?
I don't.
Crazy story.
Both, you know, $6 million, $2 billion. In aggregate, those don't really add up to a lot,
yeah,
which is
that's
great.
A good point. Yeah, it's just a little bit of money.
But if it's your personal life savings,
sure,
then it's kind of important.
What's a couple billion dollars between friends? That's what I always say.
Sure.
To nobody in particular. Thodex ran what would become their final rewards campaign, right? So like basically their last hurrah as existing as a business was between March and April in 2021. And they would, you know, this is the whole Dogecoin craze. They were going to give out free Dogecoins and a bunch are distributed and there's all.
Oh, they were passing around other types of cryptocurrencies. It wasn't that they had their own.
Oh, it was an exchange.
Okay, I got you.
Yeah, this was an exchange. So that campaign led up to a day, I think it was April 20th, of course, 420, that was named as Doge Day by these Dogecoin fans because the price is expected to go up a bunch on that day, right? And the price went up 20% on April 20th, 2021. But at the same time, users started experiencing disruptions in their transactions.
Sure.
Following a bunch of complaints, Thodex stated that the issues were due to the exchange being under a cyber attack. And the next day, April 20th, trading on Thodex was halted entirely.
Mm-hmm.
So this is, you know, April 2021. By April 21st, the next day, users could no longer access their accounts. Thodex website stated the platform was, quote, temporarily closed. I don't know about you, but if I'm rolling into Bank of America and there's a sign that says
temporarily closed,
I start getting a little nervous. Just a little tiny bit nervous.
I don't, because everything's FDIC insured. And
yeah,
so,
but the problem is they were also closed. The FDIC also had a sign up that said temporarily closed. It had one of those little signs with the clock hands on it and said, we'll be back.
Sure.
And then but it was set to a month.
It said forever.
It said January 2026. And I'm like, I don't understand. While this is happening, right, at the same time this is happening, the founder, Ozer, left Turkey for Albania with $2 billion of cryptocurrency in a cold wallet on a fucking memory key in his pocket.
Okay.
Which is nuts.
Was that memory key found? How did they know that he had that with him?
You're going to find out.
Oh, okay. Sorry. I didn't mean to jump ahead.
Remember, in the U.S., you have to declare if you're taking 10 grand
sure.
or more in or out of the country, right? If you've got more than 10 grand in cash on you and you're flying in or out of the U.S., you've got to declare that. Meanwhile, you can have $2 billion worth of bits and bytes on a memory key and you're like, meh, it's got pictures of my kids. How would you know?
Yeah, well, sure. I mean, I could encrypt it. It could be anything.
So after determining that users could no longer access their funds, and verifying that Ozar had indeed left Turkey, the financial crimes agents froze all assets of Thodex. So arrest warrants were issued for Ozar and 81 other suspects in September of 2021. So they reacted pretty quickly. The cyber crimes directorate arrested all suspects except for Ozar himself because they couldn't find him.
Mm-hmm.
And that included arresting his two siblings. His two siblings were loosely involved in the business with him, you know, loosely or deeply, I guess, depending whose account you believe. In August 2022, the arrest of Ozer was made public by the Ministry of the Interior. Albanian authorities had apprehended him at a resort after being wanted for a year.
Okay.
So for a year, he managed to hang out.
Well, sure, you got $2 billion. You're not going to hang around at some junky Motel 6. You're going to a resort.
So his story was supposedly he lived in a tent on the beach for months, living with, quote, poor people is what he said.
Okay.
Again, I don't know how you do that when you got $2 billion sitting in your pocket, but, you know, I've seen Brewster's Millions.
Well, you do it for a while until you eventually decide you want the fresh squeeze. squeezed orange juice.
No one's going to find me. I'm going to go over there and stay at the Four Seasons. Like, who would recognize me?
You know what's nicer than living in a tent on the beach?
The Four Seasons.
It's the St. Regis.
It's a small step up. Yeah, it's a small step up.
Yeah.
It's no peninsula, but, you know, hey, we're getting there. Okay, so then he waits, you know, sits for a year in an Albanian prison, sort of appealing his extradition back to Turkey. Ultimately, he tells the folks in Albania that if he's extradited, that he would not have a chance to get a fair trial. And he called it, like, a tragicomic. And ultimately, his appeal was unsuccessful. He goes back to Turkey in June of last year, 2023. And he's now looking at a prison sentence that could carry an astonishing 43,000 years.
Wow.
That's the prison sentence he's looking at.
They must have great health care there.
I got to believe his public defender was like, I think I can get that cut in half for you. I'm not sure. I'm no miracle worker, but I can probably get that cut in half for you. That's pretty good, right? I
mean, you'll be in prison for 43,000 years. Jeez. But the downside is they can keep you alive for that long. They know how to do it.
Yeah,
The doctors are so good there.
I feel like if I was ever convicted for 43,000 years, I'd be like, okay, fine, I'll plead to this, but you actually have to keep me in that cell for 43,000 years. I want like an endowment set up to keep that cell going. Anyway, when he finally stood before the court, the judges allowed Ozer to tell his story. Of course, he, you know, took the chance. He had like a full, like, a presentation. It looked like a pitch, apparently.
He probably had to make the pitch of his life.
He had like a presentation of images and graphics, and then he read from like this 60-page document, and his defense attorney was like clicking through slides, and he said that he didn't defraud anyone, he didn't smuggle money abroad, he didn't establish or manage a criminal organization, and then he said he started a company, and that's all. And he said, people got hurt, but it was really the media had simply mistaken a business failure as a criminal act. Sounds familiar, by the way. I've heard this plea before.
Oh, sure.
And then, of course, there were all these problems that weren't because of him getting hacked and sort of this, what is he called, quote, an atomic bomb of these Dogecoin panic buying and selling that drained all their funds. You know, listen to how unlucky this guy is. The day he bought the ticket to go to Albania, most of the Dogecoin withdrawals requests came in and could no longer be met. The day he was leaving the country.
The chance of that happening on the same day.
And why was he leaving the country? He was trying to sell it. So he went, he had a buyer, apparently, and he was shopping around Istanbul, in Italy and the Balkans, and he set up meetings with potential buyers in Albania. Of course, he didn't name any of them,
but
like, this is why he was leaving.
Also, generally with cryptocurrency, when you go to sell it, you need to have an in-person meeting.
Yeah, of course. They really want that. They're not big pro Zoomers.
None of those people are good with computers.
And the other thing that they don't tell you this until you get in one of these transactions, they want you to print out all the crypto when you sell it to them, too.
Print it out, yes.
You've got to print them all out and give it to them on paper. He said he had no other chance to cover the losses of the stolen cryptocurrencies, and then he pointed out that the estimated damages were actually closer to $43 million, and the number of official claims against him totaled 2,000 people. That's what he had said. There's two parts of the story that I think are the most crazy, and I'm going to tell you those now. He said that when he learned about the prosecutor's indictment, that his brother and sister were charged with fraud, and that they would stand trial in a month, and that without Ozer, they would most likely take the blame for the fall of Thodex. He spent, and ultimately spent the rest of their lives in prison. He said he had a wild idea. And he said, what if every claimant were paid back? If they were, did a crime really happen?
Well, yes. That doesn't really change the fact that a crime happened.
I know. But just listen to this thinking. This is like fucking Wile E. Coyote cartoon thinking. He said he did, in fact, have the Thodex cold wallet on him. And he told the judges. And though he claims to not remember how much was in it, convenient, he did ask his lawyer to help him pay back the roughly 2,000 plaintiffs who had lost their money. And they did, in part. He said while he was on the run, he paid approximately 185 million lira, which is about $10 million at the time, to more than 1,000 claimants.
Yeah.
And as Ozer tells it, when the cold wallet was empty, he threw it into the Ionian Sea.
As one does with evidence.
As one does. What the fuck? Like that, like your story is checking some logical boxes until you get to the, oh yeah, when it was empty, I just threw it into the ocean. Like, what? This will not surprise you. In September of 2023, he was sentenced to 11,196 years in prison by a Turkish court.
So they really cut down the original 40,000.
They did cut it down. They wanted to show some leniency for, quote, establishing and managing a criminal organization and laundering assets. Most of the other defendants were released.
Okay.
It's the longest sentence in Turkey's history, handed out months before the Republic's centennial. What do you think happened to his brother and sister?
10 years.
They each got 11,196. 6 years in prison.
Wow.
They just took the whole bunch of them and they're like, you're going to jail forever.
A long, long time.
The end. Yeah. Anyway, after the collapse, Turkey started looking to ways to regulate cryptocurrency. In 2021, they put new regulations in place, including banning the use of crypto assets as payment. which maybe was too far, but that's a different topic for a different day. What I find interesting about all of these crypto stories is the folks that get taken advantage of, which I do feel for at least a bit, they immediately go, well, why wasn't this regulated? And I'm like, that's why you
invested in it. That was your interest, yes. That was
your interest. This is what happens when there's no regulation, right? Like, you don't have to read much about the stock market in the 30s to know that it was not a place your money was going to go and come back to you.
Right.
So that's OneCoin and Thodex. Those are the two of the bigger ones. But there are so many others, right? This blockchain analyst firm called Chainalysis ranked rug pulls as the primary scam of 2021, accounting for 37% of all cryptocurrency scam revenue that year.
Wow.
Up from 1% the year before. So it was like kind of in 2021, everyone figured out, oh, fuck, we can just take all the money.
Sure, we'll just...
Like, no one's looking. Let's just take all the money. BitConnect promised a 1% daily compounded interest.
Wow.
And they took $2.4 billion from U.S. investors and as much as $4 billion globally. The CEO of Mirror Trading International, which I think was a South African company, a crypto trading company based in South Africa, defrauded users of more than $1.7 billion and then skipped town.
Okay.
TurtleDex, which was this anonymous decentralized finance storage project on Binance, reportedly vanished with $2.4 million. Meerkat fleeced investors out of $31 million. And I believe they actually ended up paying back 95% of that.
Mm-hmm.
But still, they took a whole bunch of fucking money. Do you remember the Squid token?
No.
Those guys disappeared with like $3.5 million. They had no association with the show at all. They just sort of like rode this internet meme and then just took off.
It's based on the Squid Games?
It wasn't even based on it. It was just named.
They like just took the name.
They just took the name. And it's because it's a cryptocurrency. What the fuck were they going to do? How was Netflix going to go find them?
Yeah.
And of course, who could forget Quadriga? I'm probably pronouncing that incorrectly. This was the Canadian crypto exchange where the founder mysteriously died on a trip to India with conveniently $250 million locked up in the cold wallet on his encrypted laptop.
Well, that's bad luck.
Oops. I mean, he had like I think he was just married, had like a new wife, and his new wife was like, oh, yeah, he died. Here's his laptop. It's all encrypted. And I haven't gotten to the bottom of the story. Maybe this is probably worthy of an episode.
Is he still alive out there somewhere? Is that what
that's what people think? I mean,
because you'd have a body or you wouldn't.
I believe a body was returned to Nova Scotia.
Okay.
I don't know if we know what body was returned to Nova Scotia. I have no idea. It did seem super convenient,
yeah.
But you know, who knows? I thought those were, well, you know, fun, hopefully quick little stories. Action wise. What do you do, right? How do you protect yourself? There's a couple things I think are worth highlighting. I'm pretty sure you know this, Jeff, but I'll tell you anyway. Ignore unsolicited communications just entirely.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you don't ask to talk to somebody, don't talk to them. If you get a strange email or phone call from someone who's eager to speak with you and brings up cryptocurrency, it's a scam.
Yeah.
Nobody does this.
Yeah.
I'm a fucking nerd, and I don't walk around with random people and be like, hey, you want to buy some crypto? No, it doesn't happen. Just ignore all of those messages. This one, I think, is the hard one. Verify who you're talking to, right? Verify contact information. If you're getting phone calls or emails from your bank or their institution, don't reply or use the phone number, right? That initial contact could be fake.
Of course.
Don't trust the email or phone number you saw or think you saw because it could be spoofed.
Call them back on a real phone number that you know.
Yeah. Go look them up, right, and call them back. And our regular listeners hopefully remember, don't use Siri for contact information from the web.
Yes.
I've stepped on that landmine. You guys don't do it. So reach out to them directly and find out what the hell is going on. They're not going to reach out to you and ask for money. That's not the thing your bank is going to do. And that one's hard. I think that's really hard to get people to understand. Well, you know, Jeff's phone number came up when it said Jeff Parker when he called me. And it's like, somebody could spoof that.
Sure.
And like, how do you explain spoofing? How do you know if it's spoofed or not spoofed? And now that we've got deep fakes on voices and images, it could look like you. I mean, it's all nuts.
Oh, yeah.
So I think the best advice on this that I can give is to just move slowly. Don't go quickly. Don't feel rushed. There are legitimate ways to invest in crypto and pretty much anything else, but scammers can use this high pressure technique to get you to you know, quote, invest or spend your money now
because
they don't want you to spend any time. So just pump the brakes, take a breath, look around, do a little Googling, ask some people, spend time learning about the companies you're thinking about working with. I think that's probably the best way to you know, prevent you from getting taken advantage of.
I personally love the idea of being able to move money from point A to point B nearly instantaneously in nanoseconds. None of this, you know, the 0 hour where it clears and all of that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I like that idea. The idea of keeping crypto as an investment, though, is absolutely insane.
Anywhere I see the word crypto and invest, I have to put invest in quotes.
By the way, I don't believe in cash. I said at the beginning of this,
yeah.
I don't think cash is a good investment either. I guarantee you will lose 2.5% annual average loss.
I mean,
each and every year over a large amount of time.
You really can't guarantee it. It is right up there with earth, you can't guarantee the sun will come up tomorrow. But we've got pretty good reason to think that that is what's going to happen.
Very likely.
Yeah. And if it doesn't, you probably have bigger problems.
Because we do have this rate of inflation, you get less spending power every single year.
Okay. So, and I pointed this out earlier, I'm going to say it here again. The real bad news about these crypto scams, and I mean, really just scams in general, but especially crypto scams, is that it's virtually impossible to get your money back after you've fallen for one of these traps, right? Once your cryptocurrency is gone, it's gone. Unless you can get them to willingly send it back to you.
Good luck with that.
Well, I mean, I look, on my one little quasi scam, I got them to do it. I got them to not take the money from me, but that was, I think that was more luck and right time, right place. So that's why, you know, really your best bet is spotting the signs of a crypto scam early so you can avoid it. And if you do wind up sending crypto to someone else or giving away your private keys or just getting duped in general by a fake job or whatever, the lessons that you're going to learn, you're going to pay for. And that's why I think it's super important to report that. I feel like you have a duty if you've been scammed to report it, right? Same thing I did here with my stupid little airline scam. These agencies that are here to protect us, especially in the US, they actually want to hear from you.
Yes.
And it kind of shocks me. I have a friend who had someone send them a fake passport, a doctored passport document. And I told her, like, you have to report this. And she's like, nobody cares. I'm like, I guarantee you the FBI cares about this. The FBI will absolutely care about this. It doesn't mean that they're going to go, you know, find them immediately tomorrow, but they're going to put this in a database.
Why was she sent a fake passport? Was she asking for a passport from someone?
Yeah, they use it as a form of identification to try to prove who they were. And ultimately, they were looking to rent some property from them.
Got it.
And she, her nose sort of sniffed out that, like, it felt a little weird, right? Like, they're paying from a corporation and they're paying in advance and yada, yada, yada. And then she looked at the passport and she's like, oh, it was doctored.
Yeah.
And I was like, wow. Like, how do you not doctor a passport well? And yet you're trying to pull off this scam. And as it turns
out, 2024,
a lot of people will fall for it. So I'll put a bunch of links in the show notes, but like the FBI, report it to the FBI, right? They're going to have the best jurisdiction for this in the US, and they do care about these things. Mm-hmm. The FTC, they care about these things. There's the Internet Crime Complaint Center. I think that gets distributed across to other organizations. They try to route them correctly. Of course, you got the SEC. The SEC is getting pretty aggressive with these sort of crypto exchanges and trying to figure out how to regulate them. And then you have the Commodity Futures Trading Commission, the CFTC. Those guys also will take these complaints. So I'm going to post all this in the notes. But if you find yourself in this position, don't sweep it under the rug. Tell someone. Tell someone, especially of authority, so we can help. Yeah. You know, it's whack-a-mole, but hopefully we can stamp some of this out and make it not profitable for the scammers.
Rug pulls.
Isn't that a great name?
I like that name. I think that name is so descriptive.
Bill Murray in Ghostbusters.
Oh, yeah.
I've always wanted to do this. And he pulls it and the shit goes flying everywhere. And as they move on to, like, whatever, catching the ghost, and you hear him basically in the background go, the flowers are still standing. It's the best. It's one of my favorite lines in that whole film. That. Oh, my God. I'll find it. I'm sure I can find the clip on YouTube. I'll put it in the notes. It's so good. Anyway, that's what I think of when I see rug pulls.
All right, we have to get out of here, but quickly before we do, have you seen or read anything good this last week?
Well, I saw my investment in OneCoin go down.
I'm sorry to hear that.
Yeah, of course. So you know about Coachella, right? You know what Coachella is.
I do.
And I went to that this year as, you know, the old guy, which was fine.
Sure.
I missed Old People Cella, which was last year. That was Desert Trip.
That's Old Cella?
They called it Desert Trip, okay. But everybody else called it Old People Cella. And I think the median age of the band members was like 78.
Wow.
Like, there was nobody there that wasn't an octogenarian.
I just call that the Hollywood Bowl.
You just call that your street, apparently, in your neighborhood. Anyway, so I made up for it by going to what I'm calling the Sad Midlife Crisis Cella, which was here in Pasadena on Saturday.
Sure.
Better known as Just Like Heaven, I think is the real name.
Yeah.
It was absolutely great. A bunch of bands from like the late 90s, early 2000s. We tried to guess the median age on our way in, and one of my friends said, it's probably about 33. And I was like, I'm going to take the over on that. I will tell you, the over on 43 would have easily paid.
Oh, yeah.
The headlining act pointed out that they released their one and only album 21 years ago. And you start doing the math and you're like, oh, I'm going to just cry now, right?
Sure.
In between tears, I realized I really just needed to sit because my knees hurt. And that was...
Of course.
I can't stand at festivals for as long as I used to be able to. And actually, this is true. Probably the second or third act from the end of the night, I turned to my wife and I was like, I should have worn my more comfortable shoes.
Of course.
How dare I go for looks?
Next time I'm paying for the VIP couch.
I did. I bought the most expensive tickets you could buy. And we still were like standing off the side of the stage pretending like we're young as opposed to going and sitting back on the grass. Where we could have happily viewed the show.
Saved your knees.
Heard the same thing, seen the same thing, but nope. I want to stand over here and get elbowed by some random 20-year-old.
Sure.
Anyway, how about you?
You know what speedcubing is?
Is this like a new drug or is this the thing with the little, what are they called? The little Rubik's Cube?
Yes, speedcubing is the competitive sport of solving a Rubik's Cube in seconds.
Oh, yeah. These guys are amazing.
It is a worldwide phenomenon. For nearly a decade, Felix Zemdegs from Australia has reigned unchallenged. But the cubing world is stunned one day when an unknown challenger, Max Park from California, takes home the gold medal in 2017. Since then, Max's rise to the top has been swift and steady, save for one obstacle. Felix. Okay. The two have traded wins and world records steadily, neither able to dominate while the other still competes. But rather than develop into a bitter rivalry, Felix and Max instead grew their competitive relationship into a tender yet complicated friendship. Max is highly autistic, and his family used speed cubing as a means for therapy for his nascent social skills and emotional development. They never guessed that Max's biggest rival in speed cubing would become his biggest ally in his struggles with autism. The documentary follows Max and Felix on the threshold of another world championship, both driven to win, but both rooting for each other's success.
Cool.
Oh, this is such a great, great film.
That sounds amazing. This is one of those skills that I look at and I'm like, yep, don't have that. That's not me.
I can do it. They're doing it, and some of them are doing it in 3-point-something seconds. I mean, it's just like,
that's bonkers.
Mind-boggling how quickly they can do
it. I saw a video the other day of a guy who took a solved cube and just, you know, put what looked like seemingly random movements into it, threw it into the air, caught it, random movements, into the air, caught it, random movements, then studied it for like 15 seconds, set it down, put a box over it, took another completed cube, and then just sort of looked off camera and then, quote, solved it to look like the first cube that was all fucked up, and then pulls the cover off and they're completely different. And you're like, oh, swing and a miss. And then of course he rotates it 2 times. Like,
and it's perfect.
And it's perfect. And you're like, oh, okay. So it turns out you're pretty good. Incredible.
My kid was super into speed cubing at a younger age. You get older and life gets you busy and you can't spend time focused on a tiny little cube, but it's so much fun.
I can't spend time focused on anything with my children now.
Focus on the movie, The Speedcubers, if you can. It's really good.
That's awesome.
On Netflix now.
I'll check that out.
That is the episode.
Thank you for joining us for all this nonsense, a truly terrible podcast from The Awful Company. Visit us on the web at nonsense.productions. I'm Stu Little.
I'm Jeff Parker.
If you like this program, please follow, download, subscribe, and like at Apple Podcasts, YouTube Music, Amazon Music, AntennaPod, iHeartRadio, Spotify, my favorite, Overcast, wherever you may get your podcast from.
Nonsense uses Sync Thing. Make sure you always have the latest versions of all your files on all your computers anywhere you are in the world. Sync Thing does that effortlessly. Free and open source. Be sure to check out Sync Thing.
Sync Thing.
Special thanks to our floor director, Dennis Smith.
We literally just use it for cat videos. We just send cat videos back and forth.
But we can send huge cat videos back and forth effortlessly.
First of all, that cat just needs to walk more. It's not that huge. Thank you, Dennis. We'll be here every Thursday morning for more nonsense. Please join us. This is how we follow up cicadas. We go from cicadas to rug pulls.
Cicadas, yes.
Cicadas?
The proper name once they've been knighted.
Cicadas.
Cicadas.
Cicadas. Okay. You had me there for a minute.
Cicada.